you. Thank you so much. All right. Hello, everybody. And let's get started. So hi, everybody. I'm Simon. I'm a student at UC Berkeley. I'm one of the co-leaders of the vLLM project. And you probably have heard about this project throughout the day. But today, I'm going to give you a quick deep dive into one part that will be, what is vLLM? What is our API? What is the infrastructure and architecture overall? And then as well as two small innovations we have done in our recent refactoring and in the process of scheduling. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about our collaboration with AMD, and in particular, what are the sort of performance enhancement collaboration mode that have been brought in recently. And then lastly, I'll give you a sneak peek into our Q3 roadmap. All right, so vLLM was born about 2 years ago, and our goal has been building the fastest and easiest to use open source LLM inference and serving engine. Now, over time, we have ended up building vLLM in collaboration in open source with the community, where on the one side is all the open source model provider that trained open source model, and you can see Llama, Qwen, and a lot more. And the other side is all the hardware vendor, including AMD. And in the middle is vLLM, where we support more than 100 model architecture, as well as all these hardware vendors, and most in particular, that we have all the optimization necessary to optimize open source large language model inference in your data center hardware. And this kind of built out over time as a open source project you can use, and anyone can fork and extend and contribute to, from, let's say, from 2 years ago, we're now getting to a lot of GitHub stars and a lot of GPUs are using it every day, as well as a large community contribution where we merge about more than 800 PRs every month, as well as amassed over 1,000 contributors. A lot of our major full-time contribution come from companies like Red Hat, Meta, and even including AMD. So over the past few months, you are probably seeing a lot of blog posts about the performance we can achieve for running open source model on AMD. So on the left, I'm showing one of the blog on the vLLM site talking about per token, per channel quantization for FPA model. This is specifically engineered for running larger model to fit on a smaller footprint, as well as FPA optimization. On the right side, you are seeing there are more and more guides coming out talking about what's the best way to run Llama 4, what's the best way to run other model on MI300X. And then I'm happy to say that AMD has been one of the top 10 contributor group to vLLM. And over the past 2 years, we have now completed a process where there has been a ROCm / vLLM fork that have been being kept up to date over time. But now as of end of Q2 2025, this fork is being deprecated and all the development, enhancement, and usage are falling into upstream vLLM. And lastly, we have Greg, I'm not sure if Greg is in the audience, becoming one of the vLLM committer a few weeks ago. This means Greg will be one of the person shepherding a lot of the changes into vLLM, directly owning part of the code base as well. Now, let me give you a little bit updates about vLLM's recent innovations and what we're doing when models are getting bigger, hardware is getting faster, there are so much more optimization. And the key challenge vLLM is trying to solve is not just implementing any specific optimization from a paper. Rather, it is how to integrate and combine this optimization. So what do I mean when talking about inference optimization? Here, I'm just listing some of the common software layer algorithms you are doing when you are serving large language model on data center GPUs, such as prefix caching, spec decode, chunk prefill. A lot of these techniques I'll get into a little bit later, as well as on the right side, you have a lot of kernel level optimization for that specific hardware, such as quantization, cascade, attention, and a lot more. So on the left side in particular is everything you need to do about scheduling, in particular, scheduling of requests. So when you are running data center, running LLM inference on data center GPU, you need to pack requests together, and this is where which request to run, how many to run, what are the number of tokens you generate is all part of the scheduling. And in particular, our problem has been how do you actually combine all these optimization together for maximum performance? Well, each individual optimization should work as this, but however, over the last year and a half, we have been seeing when we combine all these optimization together, we are seeing a lot of incompatibilities. So this is what I'm showing here is a feature compatibility matrix of our V0 architecture last year. And we really set out to design to solve this question. So one of the main issues of why is this so difficult, why are we having all this incompatibility, is that implementation of optimization are fragmented. They are being contributed over time, they're designed separately, there's paper coming out every month, we're trying to evaluate and implement. And the way we to solve this is a ground up redesign of how do we design a scheduler, and as how do we make sure there's a unified representation for scheduling optimizations. And the second part is more and more optimization are becoming very dynamic, as in it's not just optimizing a single forward pass in the GPU. Rather, we need to make sure to support different changes within the model inference process. So this is why we have introduced a piecewise device graph that are there to easily handle dynamism while retaining performance. So let me dive into each one specifically. One is this kind of scheduling abstraction. In particular, when we're scheduling, there's a phase called prefill and there's a phase called decode. So prefill means processing the context, processing the prompt you send to the GPU. So here, for example, we have the prompt, AI is a future of, and we're trying to ask the LLM to complete the sentence. So we have now two concepts in the scheduler that are unified. One is non-computer token. This is how many tokens we have processed so far, and as well as all the token IDs. So we can make a decision saying, well, in the current iteration, we can process the first 5 tokens. And then we can move towards incrementing the non-computer token and advancing the all tokens ID. And this is where the next iteration will be scheduling the decode, what we call. At this point of decode, you already have all the context processed and all the KV cache stored so that processing this decode is faster. We also have the same mechanism, what we call chunk prefill. This is typically what happens when you have this prompt, but the GPU cannot fit this much prompt anymore, and you cannot afford this kind of long iteration time. And therefore, we can choose only to schedule 3 tokens out of 5, and then as a next step, we schedule the next remaining 2 tokens. And this can be implemented in the same framework. And the next one is prefix caching. In some cases, you have a KV cache of the first few tokens already computed. And this is the case where you have long system prompt when you have multi-turn conversation. So system prompt is the case when you put in instruction for the model, right? That's typically before the input, as well as in cases where you have multi-turn, where you already have the previous input-output conversation. And if these are already in the GPU, we can directly leverage that. So this same framework in vLLM now supports prefix caching, where you, when you put in the tokens, we can automatically figure out which token has already been computed, and then only schedule the rest. So in this case, we can compute the cache hit and then schedule the remaining tokens. Again, the same framework can be applied for what we call preemption and recomputation. In some cases, the GPU memory is actually running out. Let's say we have thousands of requests arriving at the same time. They have some requests just keep generating and generating without hitting end of sequence. So in this case, we can have an example where we can take a request, preempt it, take it off the queue for now, and make it come back later. And when you come back, we can resume it with whatever cache is left in the GPU and recompute the parts that are missing. And then I'll have two more examples of the same unified scheduling framework that works. So disaggregated serving is a part when you have prefill, again, context processing, done in some part of the cluster, and decode in other cluster. Using the same concept, we can only pull pre-KV cache of the context from another worker that's already computed, and only schedule the rest in the decode node. And finally, this also works for a technique called speculative decoding. This is when you have the smaller model to figure out what is the big model is potentially gonna be speaking about and generating, and go verify it. Again, same framework applies, and we can schedule not just one decode, rather 3 decode tokens and verify it at one pass. Now, the second part is about dynamism. Here we're making a very bold prediction, but in order for me to explain that, let me give you a little bit of background of device graph. So when typically we're running GPU operations, the CPU is scheduling different kinds of operation, enqueuing it to the GPU. And a lot of cases we have seen, when the scheduling overhead is too high and then the transfer bandwidth is too low, where it can take a lot of overhead between the actual kernel execution. Now, about a few years ago, there's a concept called device graph that been introduced. So in AMD, it will be called hip graph. That will be able to capture the sequence operation and only dispatch it once. And this has been a very, very powerful technique to lower the latency for LLM inference. So on the left, I'm showing here is a typical layer of LLM when you have QKV projection, you send it to attention kernel, you send it to output projection, and then go through the multi-layer perception layers. Now, a lot of the technique has been about, well, we can do full device graph capture when we capture the entire DAG of operation and then dispatch it only once. So this is, in fact, the de facto mode. It provides minimal CPU overhead, but however, you have to make sure all the shapes are static and no CPU operations are allowed. And this actually does, in fact, increase the development burden. Now, but however, the prediction worth making, as well as a trend we're seeing, is that dynamism in LLM inference is increasing. There are a lot of need for dynamic scheduling. There are different kind of kernel optimizations that are just fundamentally not compatible with full graph capture mode, as well as different kind of sparse attention. There are cases where you want to do layer-wise transfer. And what does that mean is you really have to use the attention module, inside the attention module, this will be a little bit easier, to get out of the CUDA graph and do all sorts of dynamic computation without the static graph dispatch. So this is where we introduce the concept of piecewise device graph, where every other parts of the layer except attention are still captured in the graph. So they're stateless, they're easy to deal with, we can perform them using static shape, while the attention module itself is dispatching in eager mode. So that eager mode can be dynamic, can be stateful and complex. And all of this are done transparent to the model authoring experience. So when you're writing up and implementing a new model in vLLM, you don't need to worry about this at all. We're leveraging PyTorch 2.0's, in particular the Torch compile technique, to automatically split the graph across attention boundary. And this is where attention itself can be dispatched eagerly and everything else is captured using Torch compile. And just to illustrate how this is working, where it can have the full graph, but only have the attention kernel dispatched in eager mode. And then after attention kernel is dispatched, you can dispatch the next graph. And of course, this will give a lot of flexibility, but the small downside will be potentially performance harm. But what we observe here is the CPU overhead can be minimal, especially on practical devices, practical models, such as NAMA AB on MI300X. And with all this combined together, we're able to achieve in the V1 architecture, which is what you're gonna be using off the shelf today, with this kind of compatibility chart. And we'll continue to make sure to address all the small missing pieces until we have a full compatibility with all the features together. Okay, so now let me move on a little bit about how, what are the enhancements making with collaboration with the AMD engineers. And as you might recall, the AMD engineers and engineering team are a big supporter of the vLLM project. So over the last few months, they're able to migrate the V0 engine to V1 engine with a full support that can achieve for the Llama 3.170B model, lower latency and higher throughput, and same goes optimizing really much, letting DeepSeek R1 using a lot of the HBM available in MI300X to be able to, again, achieve a lower latency and higher throughput. And a lot of this work has been done leveraging what Penn has talked about two talks before, using the Ader kernel. So the Ader kernel is the kernel library, implementing all sorts of MapMul, gems, as well as attention kernel, where vLLM will be able to natively use and integrate. And then finally, it's not just making sure we're doing this kernel by kernel, it is also making sure that we can have the full system working end to end with different kinds of optimization. So what we're showing here is that we'll be able to run a 405B model with a small draft model and boost the inference latency quite a bit. And then lastly, it's not just about improving the performance. It is about making sure every single commit, every single release we ship is working end to end. And with this, what I'm showing here on the chart is this continuous integration system that is continuously measuring the system performance of a vLLM on AMD. So we have a lot of metrics we're tracking, a lot of test cases, as well as correctness tests, unit tests are being checked on a pool of more than 100 MI300X. And finally, I didn't put this on the slide, but Anush might mention this this morning, is that AMD team has been supporting open source quite a bit by sending us MI300X as well as MI355 even before it's announced today. So we'll be very much looking forward to add support and test the benefit there. And lastly, let me quickly go over the recap of the roadmap, as what I showed today is only a small fraction of what we have done. And in particular, in Q2, we have been completing this V1 migration I talked about, so you can get all the feature compatibility, as well as a sprint to focus on large-scale serving. This is when you want to deploy vLLM for the single instance to scale beyond, like let's say, hundreds of GPUs to be able to use expert parallelism and many more. And we're also natively integrating with all the post-training frameworks that's performing RLHF process, where you can use vLLM to perform large-scale rollout and batch inference. And finally, we have been achieving a lot of performance enhancement across various hardware I just mentioned. And in the next few months, what we're looking forward to is to really advance the next frontier for rack scale serving. We do believe this will be the future where you can take your model, map it very much across not just one, not just eight, but beyond hundreds of GPUs, and be able to achieve both low latency and high throughput using this system, as well as specializing vLLM for lower latency and high throughput. So this means the average case when you're taking vLLM today, it is very much using optimized for one setting that is more or less the average setting for a typical endpoint product. But however, we are excited to offer more and more specialization. And lastly, as more and more folks deploy vLLM production, we are continuously hardening for observability, scaling, and customization. And that concludes my talk, and vLLM's goal has been building the fastest and easiest to use open source LLM inference and engine, serving engine. And you can follow a lot of the links here on GitHub, on our documentation, as well as we have a Slack workspace where anyone can join and discuss a technical topic, and we're more than excited to collaborate. And with that, I'll conclude my talk, and given the time, I'm happy to take questions offline, so I'll be right next to the stage. Thank you so much.